come to this Q&A session. Oh, thank you, anyone who started the recording. When you come to this session, you basically just, what you do is that you have like a well-formed idea of what is not clear, what you didn't understand, and what you want to discuss. So in order for this time to be most productive, I think that there are two kind of types of questions. One is more of clarification type. Let's say I did some calculation and there was at a certain point a plus, which you believe it was a minus. Then I think that those kind of questions, when you want to ask about some specific details, the best thing you can do is to post that question on Slack so everyone can benefit from it. I can quickly check, and I can, in case it's something that impact the class in a major way, I can even like reshoot the video, go through the notes and correct it, right? But for those clarifications, when it's really something about a calculation, something that you have to take the notes and check whether the passage is correct, I think that the best way to go for that is to post the question on Slack. So we have a channel per lecture, so you can post in the respective channel. I think that the Q&A is more for broader questions. So like, I didn't understand what was the motivation. I didn't understand what was the flow of the calculation we did. I didn't understand why we did this. I didn't understand what we wanted to prove. Or even things that are like go beyond like the sort of details of a class, like how this is this useful to describe some process that happens in reality. So I think that it's good if you come to these sessions like with a set of points to discuss. That is the best sort of strategy to make the best use of this. Sorry, I have to respond to Antonio 1 second. I posted to everyone. Sorry, just 1 second that I have to check. Okay. Good. So, given that, I think this is like the idea I have about this session, so that it's really a discussion and sort of collective discussion about the class. Okay, so given that, I'll, in according to what I just said, I'll start by shutting up and leaving somehow the floor to you. So anyone that wants to have some clarification about what we did in the class, or even about the content, the format, even something more related to the organization of this class, everything is legit here. Yes, if you, when you ask the question, you have to unmute and you have to turn on the camera. If you do, you have, I mean, if you can turn on the camera, it's appreciated. Okay. Not everyone at the same time. It's really hard to see like only like names and not the faces. So if you, I mean, let's say turn on your camera so at least I can put some pressure on you to I can see your face and from far put some pressure for you to ask questions. So is there something you want that was not clear, or is something that you want to discuss about the class?
I'll start.
Yes.
I didn't understand when the Ali effect is used in reality, because I understood that it's when the growth goes negative, but when it's used in reality.
Okay, so the Ali effect capture a very large set of phenomena as an effective description. And the set of phenomena that Ali effect captures are cases where there is an advantage at small densities to be in, to have other individuals around you. Okay, so I gave a couple of examples which I can repeat, and perhaps you can discuss about them. So let's say that you are, I don't know, some big herbivore in the savanna, right? You are this big herbivore, and if you are by yourself, or you are, if you are in a small group, then you are more subject to predators, right? Now, if you are in a larger group, then it's sort of harder for predators to catch you, because you have some collective strategy which where you protect the weaker, etc., etc. Right? So in that case, if you are being in a group, every having other individuals like you close to you makes your per capita rate of growing larger. Right? The other example was like, suppose that you have a predator now. Right? If you are in a small pack of wolves, the probability, your ability to catch some big big animal is much smaller, right? While if you are in a big pack, it's much easier for you, and therefore your individual benefit is higher if you are in a larger group, right? So the idea is that if you are in a small group, if you are in a very small group, making the group bigger, so having a larger population, having other individuals like you close to you, produce a positive effect. Then, of course, if the group becomes too big, then the effect becomes negative, right? And there are other, so these are examples with things are more familiar with, but this is, for instance, very common in bacteria or in other microorganisms, that when they have to digest some big, some molecular compound that they feed on, they don't take this compound and transport into the cell, rather they secrete the enzyme that breaks this compound around, right? And so doing that, what this effectively does is that if you have, if you're putting the enzyme out, you are digesting not just for yourself, but also for others around you, right? So if you have other individuals like you close to you, the density of enzyme that are close to you is going to be larger. So you're going to benefit the presence of other individuals, right? While if you are alone, well, all these enzymes are going to diffuse away, and you're going to grow slower. Of course, this is a balance, right? It's a balance of being a little bit bigger, but not too big, because if you are too big, then you are always limited by the presence of resources, and therefore the effect of the population is going to always be negative. Okay, so this is in words what is the motivation of that. Yeah. Does that answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Okay. Good.
I have a question.
Yes.
In those models, we haven't included migration.
Yes.
So what would happen if we include that the dynamics becomes harder to describe or?
Okay, so let me share the screen so I can write. So let's say that we have considered so far equations like these, right? Dn dt equal to n times g of n, where this g of n is the per capita growth rate, right? And for instance, if you have exponential growth, this is a constant. If you have something linearly, this is like logistic. And you can imagine more complicated, different functional forms, which have the same qualitative behavior. Then we also consider a Lie effect, which is something where you have something like this, always for G versus N, or something like this if it is a stronger Lie effect. Okay? So these are the types of dynamics we consider. So in all these dynamics, in all these cases, what you see is that dn dt is equal to zero when n is equal to zero. Okay? And so we never, so while what migration does is that it makes dn dt larger than zero. So in practice, there is a simple way to include migration, which is just add a constant term here, right? So this term here is the migration rate. And what it does is that it add a small population and therefore n equal to zero is not necessarily anymore a fixed point. Actually, it's not anymore a fixed point, right? Because you see that in n equal to zero, this is going to be dn dt when n is equal to zero, this is going to be lambda larger than zero. Okay, so what the migration rate does is to make zero not a fixed point. Okay, so what is the relevance of that, right? For the long term behavior? Well, I mean, it always has some effect in the sense that you're adding a parameter, therefore, it's going to change the value of the fixed point. In practice, it's going to have a big effect when n equal to zero is an unstable fixed point, right? Because if n equal to zero is a stable fixed point, you expect that if you just add a small population, then this population will tend to go extinct. So basically you will not change very much the behavior of the system. While if n equal to zero is an unstable fixed point, that migration rate is enough to kick you away and push you sort of away from extinction. Okay? Is that clear, the answer? Or do you want more details?
No, that's okay.
Well, the other point is how much realistic it is. Unless you model the ecology at the global scale, so you look at the whole planet, there is virtually no ecosystem, which is no community, which is closed. So all the community are subject to migration. So in this sense, this is not realistic, but effectively, there are communities with very small rates of migration compared to the importance of other processes. So the idea is, let's first to focus on those, okay? Great. Other question, comments, doubts, suggestions?
Yeah, I have one.
Yes.
Do we always need to contrast between the results of our models and the real world in order to know if assumptions are acceptable or realistic, is there an alternative way or special requirements?
Yeah, I mean, well, that's a very good question and somehow a philosophical one even. So it depends on what is the role of models, right? So models have different roles, which are like all legit in some way. So one role of models is to explain some phenomenon quantitatively, right? So you want to predict something about a real world scenario, right? Which basically means you measure some initial condition and you want to know how the system changes over time, right? This is one role of models, which is predicting, right? More related to prediction, right? So you put in some initial conditions and you integrate your dynamics and you want to see whether it matches the data. This is one role of model. The other role of model is to not to predict something, but to test assumptions. So you want to see whether what you observe in reality is consistent with the assumption you have put in, right? It's a sort of way to understand what's actually going on in the world and try to see whether the assumption you consider at the beginning are a good assumption or not. These two are different, right? Then there is a third row of models, which is they are a tool to which like sort of shape our expectations on what can happen in general, right? So where you don't necessarily try to fit or to match your model with data, but you try to understand, given some set of assumption, what should I expect, right? Without necessarily questioning our assumption with reality, right? All these three, I mean, perhaps there are four or five, but all these three use of models are like legitimate and good use of models when you are honest about what you're doing, right? So in this class, we are never gonna do the first. So we are never gonna think of a model as something to forecast the future. We are gonna play with the first two, right? So we are gonna use models and mostly with the third. So we are gonna use models to understand what is the consequence of our assumption, okay? So especially in the ecology part, what I'm gonna show you is examples where you start from some assumption and the behavior you observe is surprising, okay? So and that is because the equations are nonlinear, et cetera, et cetera. So this is one use. The other use is to try to explain something about the natural world and therefore to have some observables about the system and then try to see whether that observables can be reproduced by the model, okay? Now, specific on this case, you can ask, is logistic growth a good model, right? Then the question, it depends how you use it, right? There is the quote, the famous quote that is, all models are wrong, but some are useful now, right? So the question is not whether this is correct or wrong. There is always some effect we haven't included. The question is how this is useful, right? And logistic growth capture well the growth of population, for instance, in a system with limited resources, when the resources are not infinite, right? If you look at the trajectory of the population, it's well captured by logistic growth. And it's also conceptually relevant because it sort of gives you an example of what happens when you have a finite carrying capacity and therefore you have a value of the population above which the population growth is negative. Okay. Let's say the dynamics of COVID, should we feed it with our logistic growth? Well, probably no, right? Without the probability, right? So, but because of many complications, right? So should I use it reliable to forecast what is going to happen tomorrow? I would say no, in many contexts, okay? I hope it clarifies. It's a very deep but hard to answer question. Okay, but it's important to have in mind that models are useful in different ways. And that models are wrong, and that's what's important. Other questions?
Yeah, I have another one.
Yeah.
In the first lectures, you say that the equations that govern the population growth are independent on time. Mm-hmm. But what if we consider also time dependent equations? Because if I think of growth, or for example, COVID growth, the time is important in
yes
in the equation.
Yes, no, that's a good point. So when I say that, I didn't mean to say that we don't. I mean that they are not needed, right? Equation with the time dependency are needed, and it's important often to include that. What I was saying is we'll start without including it. Okay. A way to think about this is when we don't include the time dependency, we are thinking that the parameters we have in our equations are sort of fixed over time and don't change over time. While in practice, they change over time and they have some time dependency, right? This is an assumption, right, if you want. If you consider a time dependency, well, there are many more complicated things that can happen. Because then you have to tell me how they depend over time. Right. The point, another way to answer your question is the following, that when some parameter depends on time, you should really think whether that should be a parameter or another degree of freedom, right? So whether we should write an equation for that parameter and then that becomes another degree of freedom, right? Which in some context is important. We'll see more example of that. So now it might seem a discussion which is a little bit, which is not well defined, but I think we will see cases where you can somehow, you can go back and forth from an equation where you have some parameter which is fixed and then making that parameter actually a dynamic variable. Okay. Thanks. I mean, even if you don't have questions on the lectures we have done, do you have questions about the organization of the class? What is going to be the content? I mean, this is also the first time we meet, so perhaps you want to know what is going to expect you in the next couple of months. So I'm happy to answer to those questions as well.
I have a question, but yeah. Regarding the homework,
yes.
How that will work for the teams and...
Oh, you are free to choose. I mean, the point is I'll give you assignments with a deadline, and by the deadline you have to submit the result of your homeworks. And you can choose whether to do that by yourself or to do it with others, and you are free to organize, so you can coordinate with whoever you want. The only thing I ask you is, since there is no, so I will not give a advantage to people that did it individually or to people that did it in teams. You can do as you want. Of course, there is an advantage, implicit advantage in doing them in groups because you collaborate. If you do that, please tell me who you, I mean, submit just one homework per group so I don't have to correct four times the same. But you are free to choose. You can, I mean, I know that it's not easy to coordinate remotely, but I tried as much as possible to create these online spaces where you see each other. So there is Slack, there is Zoom. So I think if you want to do it with other people, just ask others if they want to join, or you can, I don't know. I don't know how to suggest to organize with that, but I think I encourage you to collaborate and to, even if remotely.
Thank you.
Do you already know when will be the first assignment?
I think I'll give the test of the assignment by this week, and I'll give you not less than, let's say, 3 weeks. So I will not, let's say 2-3 weeks, I will not give you something and ask to give you back by the end of the week. So we will have time to do it.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, the point of the assignment is not to, I mean, it is an occasion for you to think about something and spend time on them. So there is no point in rushing through them, right? So that's the other point. I think it's useful. They are useful if you spend time on those and you sort of think about those well in advance, and not if you just the last day you try desperately to find a solution. Yes. But as I said to other people this morning, I mean, the point of the assignment is not to sort of assign a number to you about how good or how bad you are. The point about this assignment is sort of a role game where you try hard to do something, you try with others, and then I give you a feedback on what you've done. Right? So the best way to take advantage of that is to spend time on those.
Do you know when the course will end and when the exam, the final exam will be?
So the course will end in the first week of December. So it depends, I mean, it also depends how fast we go. It's very hard for me to balance sort of the classes and the Q&A. So in the sense that if I was giving the class, I have like 6 hours or 4 hours a week, and I just go on until I see how fast you are responding to what I'm saying, right? So now it's not easy for me to adjust the material, right? So for instance, you don't have many questions, so I should suppose that things are clear, but the group before you had many, many questions, which make me suppose that things were not clear. So I have to balance this, right? And so there is some fluctuations. But I think by the end, we should finish the first week of December, let's say, not much later than that. And in terms of the exam, once you complete the assignment, whenever you want, you can give the oral exam. So we can, it depends how it is organized in terms of physical versus remote presence. So if you will be in Trieste, we can do it in person. If you are away, we can do it on Zoom, and we have to find a way so you can sort of write. And yes, it's very hard to know how the world is gonna be in 2 months. So let's not program too much in advance, but we'll find a way.
Thanks.
And in principle, you can give the exam the day after we finish. I mean, the day after we finish the class. There is no lower limit to that. But typically, I mean, I guess you're going to give it in January. I mean, last year everyone was giving it in German. So. Good. Any other question?
No.
Well, I mean, if there are no questions, I don't want to, I mean, keep you here for other 30 minutes to sort of with me asking you if you have questions. So I'm happy to stay longer if you want to discuss about something. Otherwise, we can see each other next week as you want. And for
Professor. Yeah. I have one more question.
Yes.
So when discussing the sudden node bifurcation, right? In the end, you basically told us the relation between P tilde and star, right? And in the comment you said, okay, if we change P tilde and we put it equal to 1/4 minus epsilon, then we have some value of n star, which tends to k half, right? And if you change p tilde above 1/4, then n star collapses immediately to zero.
Yeah, immediate, okay. Okay, go ahead with your question.
The immediate part.
Yeah. Thank you. It's not, yes, so it's not immediate in the sense that you integrate the dynamics and poof, magically everyone dies and go to extinction. Yes, immediately in the sense that, okay, I tell you why I said immediately. The reason why I said immediately is that I was thinking at the following scenario. You change the parameter over time, right? But then you change it slowly and therefore the dynamics always go at equilibrium. Right. So on the time scale of changing that parameter, so on the time scale where you go to equilibrium immediately, the change is immediate, right? But the point is, imagine that you change dynamics, what you see is that the, so let's draw graphs. So what is going to happen is that if you have n star, and here you have your parameter p tilde, here was 1/4, and you do something like this. So here you have k, here you have k over 2, and then here you have the bifurcation point, right? So suppose that you, let's say you are with, you are at p tilde minus epsilon, right? And you are at a value, here you are at p tilde minus epsilon, and you are at a value k over 2 of n, and here I'm looking at the dependency on time, right? So p tilde minus epsilon, you are here, okay? And then you cross, sorry, p tilde equal to epsilon plus 1/4. So if you are here, you stay to k half, right? And then if at this point you change p tilde and you go to 1/4 minus epsilon, then the population, what is going to do? Well, it's going to decrease and go to another fixed point. But there is no discontinuous behavior in time, right? There is never discontinuous behavior in time of n. Okay. And what changes is that if now you are at p tilde 1/4 plus 2 epsilon, you are here, right? So the dependency of this point is continuous below 1/4, but then where you go for large times is not continuous. But as you said, is not immediate in the sense that here you have a time scale which is not zero. Okay.
So just for clarification, n star stands for the a fixed point, okay. Yes, so the fixed point changes.
Yes, okay. You're saying this is like some f of n, okay. And you are f n star.
Right? Star, okay.
And the idea is that you are also tracking the stable fixed point. Okay. So here you have n star, and you know that this is a stable fixed point. Right? And here the population collapse. Okay.
Okay.
We are going to see, I mean, in the equation that we consider, which was dn over dt rn 1 minus n over k minus pt minus p. Now, as I said, this model is not realistic because this doesn't have a dependency on n, right? In practice, I mean, what happens for a true fold bifurcation is that there is going to be here another stable fixed point. So what happens is that you are in this stable fixed point, and then you jump to the other stable fixed point, okay? You jump, I mean, you jump in the sense that you move continuously to that fixed point. Mm-hmm. But if you only look at the time, the infinite time limit, then you jump, okay? In the next class, we are going to see explicitly an example where you, where we have a realistic model with a fold bifurcation.
Okay.
So we'll see that more clear.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good. Last call. Any other question, comment?
Yeah. Regarding the bifurcations, in every type of bifurcation, we have taken different assumptions. But why we have taken these particular assumptions for every type of bifurcation?
Okay, so those assumptions are, so the point is that you can ask, let's suppose that I have a bifurcation. What is a bifurcation? Is a point where the fixed point will stability, right? What you can do is that you can expand around the fixed point, okay? And you can consider different combinations of terms, okay? Now, if you consider just the first terms, so you forget cases where all these terms goes to zero. If you consider only the first terms, you basically have few combination of cases, right? And the three I describes are the four I describe, considering different, the subcritical and the supercritical, are the cases you can have. Of course, you can have many more cases because you can say all the first three terms of the expansions are zero, and then there are other terms. But in practice, they would reduce to the previous ones. So it might seem that they are like just specific choices and you could have many more, but in practice for one dimensional system, these are the thing you can do. Right? You can try to come up, let's consider the first three terms in the expansion, and let's try to come up with some bifurcation, which is not one of the type you I described. That's not possible. Okay. I haven't proved that those are the only ones. Okay. But yeah.
Okay. So basically, what we have done is that we have chosen only the first terms in expansion, and then we have chosen the only three possibilities to form different types of.
Yes. They are actually four because the supercritical and the subcritical are.
Okay. Yes.
Yeah, exactly. Yes.
Okay, thanks.
Yes. Because you want, I mean, the point is that to have a bifurcation, you want something nonlinear. So if you want, I can give you sort of an intuition of why you want something nonlinear. So you need a term which is at least x squared. Okay. You need something, because if everything is linear, so if everything is linear in the sense that you have x dot equal to r plus rx plus x, this is a linear equation. And in a linear equation, you cannot have a bifurcation. Okay, so this one doesn't have a bifurcation. The reason why it cannot be, I mean, it can have a bifurcation, but in the sense that is either the fixed point is either a finite value or that value becomes unstable and you go to infinity. So this you ruled out. So you need an x squared. So you need an x squared, what you can do two things. You can say I have something like this, or I have something like this. Okay.
Sorry, if you're writing, we're not seeing it.
Oh, apologies. Sorry. So you cannot have something that is linear, okay, like this, because this doesn't have a bifurcation, okay? So it has a bifurcation, but it's a bifurcation where you go from zero to infinity as a fixed point. So it doesn't count. So you have this, okay? So these are the two sort of choices you can make with x squared, okay? Of course, you have the combination of the two, but the combination of the two is basically you have one of the two. It depends on how you, what value of parameters you choose, okay? So these are the two combinations you can do with the term x squared, and then you can do the term x cubed, right? Okay, but this is only relevant, this is relevant only if the term x squared is not relevant. So if you add something like this, okay, this becomes subleading and therefore you are back to this case. Right? It's because you are doing an expansion, therefore you have to count the first term that, you have to consider the first term that counts.
Okay, thanks.
I mean, the other point is that it's true that you can have things like R cube plus X fifth, where all the other terms were zero. But in practice, this reduces to Rx, what is this? This, let's say that this is a minus. Right? Say that you have something like this, right? This looks fundamentally different from that. But you can write this x dot, x cube, or x squared rx minus x. What I want to do like this, right? So it still has the same symmetry as a pitch for bifurcation, so it's going to behave like a pitch for bifurcation. So actually, sorry, it's better to write it in this way. X cube r minus x squared. Okay. So this is still two fixed points, which is x equal to zero and x equal to plus minus r if r is positive, and there's all the characteristics of a pitch for. Right? Even if as a different form, but you see that. So this is, so the point is, what is the relationship between the first, the two terms you have in the expansion? Now that's not an, that's not true anymore when you go to higher dimensional systems. So if you go from one dimension to two dimensions, you have different types of bifurcation, and we'll sort of mention them. But the point is that as you grow in dimensionality, there is not a clear classification of bifurcation. The reason why I discuss those is because, for instance, the fault bifurcation is an example where you have something unexpected, right? You have an equation which is smooth, et cetera, but the behavior at large times, the behavior as a function of parameters is discontinuous, right? And so therefore is surprising. Good. Any other question, clarification?
No, that's clear. Thanks. Okay.
Great. So if there is nothing, then Well, I'll add new videos, and we can keep, I mean, we'll see each other again next week. So we'll always have the Zoom at 4 p.m. Italy time. And then if you are in Trieste, you can also, if you want, join the other sessions. Yes, if you need clarifications or there is something unclear, also use Slack, which I think it's very useful for sort of fast, simple questions. Okay. Great. And if there is anything else, let me know. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye. Thank you.